Hello. Hello, thank you for inviting me. My name is Vladimir. I'm an artist and curator from Chisinau, Republic of Moldova, and I work as a curator in Oberliht Association, an association called Young Artists Association, but founded in 2000, so 15 years ago, and meant to support young artists and integrate them into international artistic circuits. I will start with several short presentations about the context so that you get a better understanding of the country I come from and the city of Chisinau. So in Moldova, before the Soviet Union disintegrated, art was intensely used as a propaganda tool in order to promote the ideology of the state, of an authoritarian state, and its policies. At that time, compared to today, art was perceived as a powerful tool and was used to a large extent by that state. By definition, culture was national in form and socialist in content, and was contributing to the establishment of a Soviet cultural identity representative for the citizens of all 15 Soviet republics. A big number of cultural institutions were built in order to support that mission. Museums, theaters, cinemas, concert halls, followed by a large network of houses of culture that was conceived for rural areas. All this infrastructure was complemented by so-called artist unions, which were organized in order to control the artistic production that was commissioned by the Soviet state. Here are the members of Union of Writers having a collective 30-day and cleaning the territory outside of the union. After Moldova gained independence in 1991, a revival of national culture took place, supported by the newly established ties with the neighbor country of Romania due to common Romanian language and similar historical and cultural traditions. In 1996, the Soros Foundation establishes a contemporary art center in Chisinau. The center's mission stressed the support of a new generation of socially to support a new generation of socially active artists capable of questioning the legitimacy of the official cultural policy with its inheritance of the totalitarian past. In this sense, the center is in a continuous search for cultural forms which would correspond to the newly established social, political, and economic order of a society in transition. The former Soros Center for Contemporary Art received support till 2001, so about 5 years, when it had to reorganize and become an independent institution. In the meantime, several other organizations and Oberliht Association, in which I work among them, were founded, and that was the moment when the independent culture scene appeared on the stage. So, if in between 2001 and 2009, independent culture was not subsidized due to political reasons, as it was perceived as a threat to political course promoted by the Communist Party. We had a Communist Party who was ruling, who wasn't the communist from Soviet time, but was a kind of successor of that party ruling between 2000 and 2009. They were considering the independent culture as a threat, so they wouldn't support it at all. Then, after April 2009, culture was simply not listed among the priorities of the new government. It was not considered from the economic point of view and was totally neglected. Moreover, due to the economic instability, culture was seen as one of the last fields to be taken care of. Chisinau administration. Chisinau is capital of Moldova with about 800,000 inhabitants, betrays similar attitudes. The local Department of Culture has no cultural strategy, neither the employees of the department have any kind of vision about the role of culture in the city. The city department is in charge of organizing national holidays and populistic events for the masses, propagating national values and identity through pseudo-rural traditions, folk dances and songs. Like in this example. So I will go to 2013. In 2013, a music collective made an artistic statement using the flat space situated in Chișinău on Bucharest Street, right in front of the cultural department. They have opened an alternative cultural department, and during the whole week, one whole week, a group of young people were there every evening playing music and accepting other artists to join and play with them. So it was a kind of alternative event to the policy, official policy that the cultural department of the city was promoting and is still promoting. I will switch to a different context now and will try to explain you the context in which we as Oberliht are active. So very briefly, what is Oberliht Association? We started in 2000 with an artistic collective. It's not anymore an artistic collective today. It's more a platform for producing projects and events. And what we do is several things. One is supporting artistic production. Another is doing research on public space transformations. And this is very much linked to theoretical activity and work. We try to get involved and produce some advocacy action. Also community building, education, and publishing activities. The artistic context in which we work, I can easily describe in five slides or six. One is lack of money and time. And for us as artists, both are needed to be active, and none of them we have. There is no art market in Chișinău, neither in Moldova, but we have a central market where you get everything. The main cultural industry is the wedding industry, so it managed to absorb all the resources, creative resources that we had from visual artists, singers, photographers, filmmakers, dancers, and so on, stage designers. They are all in wedding industry, and it's the most powerful industry we have. The independent culture scene is very little. There are a lot of empty places still. And all the independent cultural production is supported by foreign funds. There is another context, the context of city of Chișinău. It's a quite interesting city that was built during and formed under influence of different political regimes. It was a small village and market before 1812. In 1812, Moldova as a region becomes a part of Tsarist Russia, becomes a gubernia, and receives a new urban plan. So Chișinău becomes capital city. It develops about 100 years as the capital of Bessarabian gubernia. Between First and Second World War, Bessarabia reunites with Romania, and then it loses its capital status, and it has different type of transformation processes. And in 44, it becomes the capital of the Soviet Republic of Moldavia, and a new type of transformation and the development of the city happens. Then in 1991, Chișinău, Moldova becomes independent, the Soviet Union falls, and I will shortly go through the consequences of these last 25 years. What happened to the public space in the city basically very recently. First of all, we can witness a lot of spaces with social importance, with of public use that disappear. And we have sport infrastructure. This is the national stadium being demolished in 2007. This is another stadium which stays empty for many years already. This is Valemorilor Lake, former Komsomolist Lake, which went through an ecological catastrophe 2006. The building of the circus is closed since 2006. This is a cinema which becomes a praying house. And this is another cinema which was never finished, was reconstructed to become a shopping mall together with a cinema probably, but was never finished and still is staying like that. And this is what happens to architectural heritage in the city. And these are the new symbols which come to the, which appear today. So this is the this other context. This is the other context which we received. And as an artistic association, we try to interact and take attitude towards this transformation. I will show you a short trailer from a project we organized in 2008. It was called Interventions. We invite artists basically to intervene in different city spaces in order to change something. So these were very ephemeral interventions, some of them lasting a few hours, some of them a few days, pointing out to some issues which the artist found relevant or important in the city space. They didn't last long, and one of our wish was to reclaim from in the city as a more permanent space for culture and socially engaged artistic projects. And that's how Kios project has emerged. As a consequence, we asked Stefan Russo to design us a space which would be a replica of a Soviet apartment, which we finally produced and built with our own means, or means that we attracted from somewhere else, and installed in front of cultural department of the city. And this is probably the only space that was built in the last 25 years for cultural purpose. It makes a few references. One is a reference to the apartment exhibitions, which was a movement in Soviet Union when artists censored by the state would show their works in their flats to their friends. And we still show our works in a Soviet flat, although there is no censorship anymore, but there are no other means to show our work somewhere else. And the other reference, which is very important to me, is that it It offers an alternative to the existing landscape, institutional landscape that we have in the city. Those cultural institutions which we inherited from Soviet time or before, theaters, museums, and so on, which are basically very closed institution and continuing operating the same way they operated in the Soviet time. And these are institutions of control of what what artists are doing. And the flat space is an alternative to that in that sense that it's an open space and it is accessible, first of all, and it's not controlled by us. It's a space which can be used on daily basis by anyone who wishes. When we installed it on the square, we realized that we put it in a parking, although it was a public square, which became in the meantime a parking place. And we had situations like that or like that. And it's a general phenomenon. We have drivers who park all over the city in very nasty ways. So some of the interventions which were organized around flat space started to expand, and somehow the content of the flat started to spill out into the square. And this is a project by Jarek Sedlak, and he's a Czech architect, but he did an artistic work by planting flowers on the square during one morning and basically making the square pedestrian and opening or allowing people to imagine something else in that spot, because they couldn't otherwise see something behind this image of a parking. Another project was realized a year later. We produced some kind of extension to the flat space. You know, in Chisinau, but also in other post-Soviet countries, people extend their private spaces. They build a balcony, they add something on the roof, they dig into the ground a few square meters. So they win some private space, taking it from public space. And we use the same strategy. We just extended the flat with another and created another space, an open-air cinema, and also blocked the entrance to the parking. And we had a series of screenings in that space. And in this process, we collaborated with architects. And that's what we regularly already doing. We collaborate with different professionals from different disciplines, because that's where the knowledge comes from, knowledge about public space. And what architects are doing is that they don't only change the vision of the space, they can also change the function of the space. And that is very interesting. They are more concrete in their work. And finally, it was a totally different space. This is a video, but probably doesn't. No. Okay, we'll skip it. And it's an example how can a square and the life of a square can be changed through different activities and also by involving very different people. Another intervention we did was in front of Chekhov Theater, an abandoned pool, which was cleaned. We built access there and made a screening about demolition. And it was making reference to one demolished monument by one hotel, which is behind there. They wanted to build a congress center, and they did it illegally, the demolition. They changed the numbers of the street number so that the monument wasn't anymore on that number. It was like an interesting trick. So 1 year later, we reminded to this hotel administration and just to inhabitants of the city about this fact of demolition. And we also had artists contributing with other works, video works on this topic, how our cities are being changed and identity being changed through demolition. And actually what happens to this hotel is that there is a kind of boycott on the side of civil society. They don't rent rooms, they don't rent spaces, don't do conferences there. And there are ways to act post-event in an efficient way. And we try to remind this way to the business in our city that they should act legally. And maybe one more activity which will connect a bit more to the urban planning issue and the work we do on the level of city and urban policies. It was a mapping workshop during which we mapped different abandoned, mainly, places in the city, because these are the places which are easily taken over by the developers. They are not cared neither by the inhabitants nor the city has any responsibility for them. And we identified this issue of a boulevard which was planned in the 70s, which we didn't know about. We learned after this mapping workshop. Then we mapped those locations along this boulevard. And then we started to think, what can we do about that? And it was very... I think I switched to different slide, sorry. It was interesting discovery which made us work last 3 or 4 years. We arrived into a park, and with the inhabitants living around that park, we tried to build a community which would take care of the park. And just to conclude, the park is situated here. Oops. No, I'm just trying to point to the map. It doesn't say. It's just on the top. So this is one of the locations, and we did different works along the boulevard, acting together with the local communities which are living and using those spaces, making them aware of the consequences of a boulevard which was planned in the 70s that was initially 90 meters wide. What would it bring? And also trying to act on policy level and to make the city reconsider such a project, and building a park with a community like a stone on the way of this boulevard. So our work is very much about democratizing public space. It's about creating new infrastructure for artists to act in the city. And it's about increasing access to different groups of people who are excluded for different reasons, from either access to public space. We have still groups like LGBT community, or we have some religious group and others, homeless, but also who are have a lack of access to cultural activities. And we try to increase our through our work also access to the culture itself. Thank you.